In the 1920s, Friedrich Wilhelm Murnau was regarded as one of the most renowned directors of cinema. His first great success was Nosferatu. This is Bielefeld in Westphalia. Murnau was born here on December 28, 1888, as Friedrich Wilhelm Plumpe. His birthplace in Bahnhofstrasse no longer exists today. During World War II, Bielefeld was bombed heavily. Almost nothing of what Murnau saw of his native town as a child still remains today.
Ich erinnere mich gut an die Erzählungen meines Vaters, wie es zu Hause bei ihnen zuging. Es waren ja 5 Kinder, 2 aus der ersten Ehe meines Großvaters und die 3 Brüder Murnau, sein Bruder, mein Vater und mein Onkel, der auch sehr früh gestorben ist. Und die 3 wuchsen ja zusammen auf, aber mit ihren größeren Halbgeschwistern. In Wilhelmshöhe wohnten sie sehr schön in der Nähe vom Schloss und hatten dort an sich ein herrliches Leben. Aber sein Vater war sehr streng. Und bei Tisch zum Beispiel mussten sie immer erst stehen, durften sich nicht hinsetzen, bevor nicht die ganze Familie da war. Und mein Onkel hatte immer, so wie er lesen konnte, also Murnau, hatte er immer Reklamhefte auf seinem Stuhl liegen. Und wenn der Vater die sah, dann hat er sie also gleich wegbefördert, weil er nicht wollte, dass er beim Essen las. Er hat anscheinend da schon immer gelesen.
When the young Wilhelm decided to become an actor, he got in serious conflict with his father. In 1910, he changed his last name from Plumpe to Murnau, a small town near the Bavarian Alps where he had spent vacations with his friend, the poet Hans Ehrenbaum Degele. Later, Ehrenbaum Degele introduced him to the circle of friends around the painter Franz Marc and the poetess Elsa Laska-Schuler. In the Café des Westens in Berlin, the two friends founded the literary magazine The New Pathos, together with the poet Paul Zech and the painter Ludwig Meidner. Meidner later painted a portrait of Hans Ehrenbaum and the young Murnau.
Und die Geschwister taten aber eigentlich immer alles für ihren Bruder Wilhelm. Also er war derjenige, der sich gemütlich draußen in den Liegestuhl legen konnte und er las immer zu, wo man ihn auch traf. Und er teilte dann seine Wünsche den Geschwistern und die haben die auch alle ausgeführt. Und nachdem sie damals das Puppenspiel entdeckt hatten, haben sie eben sehr viele Puppenspiele gemacht. Die eine Halbschwester Ida war also auch sehr begabt. Die hat sehr viel gemalt. Die saß immer im Garten und malte. Und die haben dann die Kulissen alle fertiggestellt und das aufgebaut und haben also wunderbare Puppenspiele schon gemacht, als er noch zur Grundschule ging in den ersten Jahren. Und später an der Oberschule ging Murnau also schon sehr viel ins Theater und hat immer diese Stücke übernommen, und um sie zu Hause dann wieder aufzuführen. Und mein Vater erzählte, dass sie dann also eine große Bühne schon für ihn gebaut haben. Und da hat sein Vater sogar dran geholfen, ja, obwohl er nicht so sehr begeistert war von diesen Fähigkeiten und Tätigkeiten seines Sohnes Wilhelm. Murnaus Mutter stammte aus Floto und sie hatten zwar eine sehr bekannte Familie, sie hatten eine große Brauerei. Und sie selbst war sehr begabt, sehr künstlerisch, sehr begabt und spielte zum Beispiel wunderbar Klavier, konnte sehr gut singen und sie unterstützte die Fables von ihrem Sohn Wilhelm. Ja, während er eben mit seinem Vater immer ein bisschen Schwierigkeiten hatte, weil der natürlich wollte, dass er also einen, wie es ja hieß, keinen brotlosen Beruf erwarb, ja, als Künstler, sondern Lehrer wurde, ja.
Max Reinhardt, the most celebrated theater director of his time, made it possible for the young Murnau to play the role of the knight in the play The Miracle at his actor's school. Later, Murnau studies acting with Berthold Held. At the same time, he appears in many of Reinhardt's productions and goes on tour through Germany with the ensemble. Many of the actors and film directors who came from Max Reinhardt's ensemble helped create the early renown of German cinema. For instance, Ernst Lubitsch, Paul Wegener, Heinrich Gehlein, and Murnau himself.
Murnau war im Krieg, anfangs im 1. Garderegiment. Und da lag er lange Zeit in Litauen, in der Nähe von der Düna. Und da schreibt er auch in seinen Briefen, kommt das. Da hat er 8 Monate ununterbrochen im Schützengraben gelegen. Und diese Zeit war wohl sehr schwer. Er muss sich dort seine Nierenkrankheit zugezogen haben, unter der er sehr litt. Er war viel in Behandlung später und musste in Berlin bereits sich Operationen unterziehen. Aber es war dann so, dass er natürlich durch diese schwere Erkrankung darauf hingewiesen wurde, dass er nichts trinken durfte, kein Alkohol, nicht rauchen und von da ab also entsprechend leben musste, wo er sich auch nachgerichtet hat. Er hat also in seinem Leben praktisch dann nie mehr Alkohol getrunken und nicht mehr geraucht und immer sehr vorsichtig gelebt.
Up until then, Murnau did smoke. In a letter from the front, he asked his friend, Hans, for cigarettes of the Memphis brand at 5 pennies apiece because he couldn't get them in the trenches. A photo of Murnau smoking survives today. For Murnau, who had become a reconnaissance pilot, the war had already ended in 1917. Fed up by the everyday drone of the war and depressed by the death of his friend Hans, who was killed in battle, he survived an emergency landing in neutral Switzerland and was interned there until the end of the war. During this time, he writes screenplays and acts in the theater. After the war, the actors Ernst Hoffmann and Conrad Veidt introduced him into the world of filmmaking. Between 1919 and 1920, he directs 7 films, which are considered lost today. Murnau's first film was The Blue Boy, with Ernst Hoffmann playing the role of the Blue Knight, inspired by the painting The Blue Boy by Gainsborough. A young nobleman lives in a castle, which is the only inheritance left to him, although according to family lore, in the castle there exists a hidden and so far undiscovered emerald. One night, he dreams that one of his forebears comes down from his painting and shows him where the emerald is hidden. And sure enough, he finds the emerald the next morning. A group of gypsies comes to the castle. The nobleman falls in love with a young gypsy who bewitches him, makes him obedient, and in the end takes everything he owns. After the theft of the emerald, the gypsies flee. Only when an actress appears at the castle does the nobleman win back his joie de vivre and hope for a new future. The location shots were taken at the moated castle Vischering, not far from Murnau's birthplace, Bielefeld. Murnau's second film was Satan, a film in 3 parts. The first part, The Tyrant, plays in ancient Egypt. Conrad Veidt, in the leading role, embodies 3 incarnations of Satan. Robert Vina, who later became famous for the cabinet of Dr. Caligari, wrote the script and was the artistic director. From this part, some fragments with strong erotic appeal exist today, as in this scene with Fritz Kortner and Saja Getza. The second part, The Prince, takes place at the court of the Borgias. It is a horrible story of murder and passion, inspired by Victor Hugo's drama, Lucrezia Borgia. The third part, The Dictator, is a modern drama depicting young leftist extremists who want to imitate the Russian Revolution in Germany. In 1919, Murnau makes another film, Longing, which has also been lost. The script was written by Karl Heinz Gerasi, and it again features Conrad Veidt and his wife, Gussie Hohl. In 1920, The Hunchback and the Dancer is made. The film tells the story of a hunchback who discovers a diamond mine in Java. Back in Berlin, he falls in love with a dancer and tries to woo her with self-made perfumes. When the dancer starts an affair with Baron Percy, the jealous hunchback produces an elixir that will kill anybody who kisses the dancer. The merchant Smith, who had discovered the liaison between the dancer and the Baron, is the first victim of the deadly elixir. The next victim is the Baron himself, who also becomes deadly ill. In a dramatic finale, the dancer snatches the antidote from the hunchback, and as a result, he dies. Carl Mayer was the author of this strange story. The Janus Head, shot in March of 1920, is a very free adaptation of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Conrad Veidt, who again appears in the main role, years later still signed his letters to Murnau with Dr. Jekyll. Bela Lugosi, in his film debut, plays the role of the butler. Evening, Night, Morning, again with Conrad Veidt, was one of the many detective films which Eric Palmer produced for the Decla Bioscope Company. Maritza, called the smuggler's Madonna, made at the end of 1920, completes the list of the early films by Murnau, all of which are missing. In 1920, Murnau leaves this house in John George Street to move finally to Grunewald, one of Berlin's choicest neighborhoods. The mother of his friend Hans, who died in the war, willed her house at 22 Douglasstrasse to Murnau. There, Murnau settles down with his new friend Walter Spies, a young painter born and educated in Russia, who was a member of the November Group. Another member is Heinrich Richter, the set designer for many of Murnau's films, who painted a portrait of Murnau in 1920.
Also es ist sehr, sehr wahrscheinlich, Walter Spies hat später, in den späten 30er Jahren, aber sicherlich unter politischem Druck, selbst geäußert, er hätte mit der Novembergruppe nichts zu tun gehabt. Die Novembergruppe gilt ja als sehr links. Das ist aber wahrscheinlich nicht die Wahrheit, denn es gibt sehr viele Indizien dafür, dass er sich an den Veranstaltungen der Novembergruppe beteiligt hat, auch deswegen, weil er ja Musiker war und die Novembergruppe sich ja bekanntlicherweise den Musikern öffnete. Und er hat auf mindestens einer Veranstaltung der Novembergruppe auf dem Klavier begleitet. Er wurde immer in den Ausstellungen der Novembergruppe in den 20er Jahren gemeinsam mit den Kollegen der Novembergruppe ausgestellt.
Spies had worked in Dresden with Berthold Viertel, another friend of Murnau. He designed stage sets for Knut Hamsun's play Das Spiel des Lebens. Murnau and Spies had common predilections. Murnau had studied music and would have liked to have become a painter. Only a handful of Murnau's drawings exist today, for instance, in his scripts, and also in a letter to his friend and co-worker at the Max Reinhardt Ensemble, Lothar Meuthel. At another occasion, Murnau declared that he had started to paint, but that he was not able to translate his ideas to the medium. It was at that time that he became interested in the cinema.
Er hat gesagt, er fühlt sich wie der Raphael ohne Hände. Er sieht es alles, aber er kann es nicht malen.
Murnau had many left-oriented friends and co-workers. Due to his horrible war experiences, he decided to work, together with Hans Janowitz, on an anti-war film project, but he could not find anyone to produce it. During the summer of 1920, Murnau shoots Journey into the Night, with Conrad Veidt in the leading role. A 36-year-old graphic artist, Alban Grau, creates the advertising material and posters for this film. Grau was fascinated by the sensibility and artistic creativity which Murnau used to express his vision. Be it thunderstorms or clouds, waves or trees moving in the wind, such images not only showed the hidden forces of nature, but also revealed the feelings and emotions of the actors. The paintings by Caspar David Friedrich and his darkly mysterious vision of nature inspired Murnau. Murnau succeeded in creating a romantic as well as magic atmosphere in his films, following the styles of painters like Dahl, Schinkel, or Becklin. Alban Grau was deeply impressed by these images because he himself was influenced by the occult.
Die Verbindung zum Okkultismus ist die, dass der Meister vom Stuhl, das heißt der Vorsitzende der Pansophischen Loge, mit Sitz in Berlin war. Die wurde gegründet von Heinrich Drenker. Das ist, sagen wir mal, die direkte Verbindung, das weiß man sicher. Er hat noch andere Verbindungen, zum Beispiel zum OTO. Er soll von Drenker auch in den OTO, in den Orientalischen Templerorden, eingeweiht worden sein, wo auch Aleister Crowley drin war. Und sicher ist auch, dass Crowley persönlich kannte.
The English magician and occultist Aleister Crowley, also known as the Great Beast, influenced the occultists in Germany through his books and his magazine Equinox. Crowley wanted to be elevated to Grand Master of the occult, but Grau rejected this idea by the magician because it reminded him, as he put it, of the time of Atlantis. During that time, according to the interpretation of the Theosophists, a tyrannical race ruled. In 1921, Grau, together with Enrico Dankman and other occultists, founded the Prana Film Production.
Das ist eine theosophische Zeitschrift von 1910 bis 11. Die erschien also in ca. 8 Folgejahren. deutschsprachig für die Nachfolger der Theosophie unter dem Namen Prana, während aber nicht nur Prana-Film, sondern auch noch für andere Sachen der Name Prana oft verwendet wurde in 20er Jahren. Es gab auch ein Versandhaus namens Prana, die nicht nur okkulte Literatur, sondern auch Räuchermittel und Räucherkerzen und solche Sachen früher vertrieben haben, Horoskope zum Beispiel. Prana, als Prana bezeichnet man im Indischen, also genauer gesagt im Sanskrit, im Yoga die Lebenskraft.
Alban Grau offered Murnau the chance to direct Nosferatu, the first film he wanted to produce for Prana Production. Nosferatu is based very freely on Bram Stoker's novel, Dracula. Grau, who took over as the artistic executive producer, drew the designs for every single scene. He took his inspirations from the illustrations by Hugo Steiner Prague for Gustav Meyrink's novel, Gollum. Even the face of the vampire is supposed to be based on one of Steiner Prague's pictures. Henrik Alleen, script author of Der Gollum and a member of the Order of Rosicrucians, wrote the script for Nosferatu. Supposedly, Grau had the first idea for Nosferatu when he observed a spider sucking the vital juices from its victim. This idea of a vampire which sucks out blood, the force of life, the soul contained in the blood, is the basic idea of Dracula. In his novel, Bram Stoker conjures the fear of the changes caused by the emerging modernity, which, so he fears, will congeal the soul in the blood. This fear arises from Stoker's religious beliefs and was widely felt in the second half of the 19th century. Based on a literal interpretation of the Bible, Stoker believed that blood is life. Henrik Alleen worked closely together with Murnau and Grau, discussed conscientiously all preparations, and assisted them with most of the shooting of the film in Slovakia and Germany. In his own copy of the script, Murnau marked the locations where he wanted to shoot the film. These notes show that he had planned to film some scenes in Lübeck. In fact, there exist in Lübeck today those abandoned warehouses that Nosferatu wanted to purchase in the film. These are the former salt lofts of the city. Since the 1920s, almost nothing has changed here, even if today a few trees have grown that partly block the view. Murnau notes in his script, framing with window. For this framing, the team put a grid in front of the camera and shot at this harbor dam that still exists today. A Lübeck newspaper of the time listed each of the locations. Some of them, for instance, Kolk Street and Devenau Street, have vanished from the cityscape after attacks by Allied bombers. Near Devenau Street, not far from the salt lofts, a few buildings have yet to be identified. There was only a limited budget available, so the scenes had to be shot quickly. One can see from the shadows that very little time had passed between the two shoots. From old photos, one can see that some of the original locations of Nosferatu that survived the war have been damaged or changed during the past decades or don't exist at all today. and the buildings that were already dilapidated then did not withstand the passing of time. These crooked alleys near the salt lofts were in reality narrow passageways and inner courts, which now, after renovation, cannot be recognized. Everything was situated very close together. The lofts, Devonhouse Street, the narrow passageways of Blomsgang, and Hutter's house, situated on a small square near the Egaden Church. Hutter's house has changed little since the time the film was made. On the other side, there stands the church that could have been used in the film. Perhaps the church elders did not want to give permission for such a sinister purpose. But Murnau stuck to his idea that Hutter's house had to stand next to a church and that the vampire would pass in front of it. Next to it stood the Freemasons' Lodge of Lübeck, perhaps a connection with the occultist Alban Grau and Henrik Galeen. Not far from there are further locations of the film. According to Murnau's script notes, the scene when Professor Wolfer and Hutter meet each other should have been shot in Lauenburg. To the contrary, it was shot in Lübeck, in a courtyard at Glockengeisser Street. It turned out that the two streets that look completely different in the film are really one and the same street, only filmed from different perspectives. In the middle of July 1921, after finishing the shoots in Lübeck, the film team moved 60 kilometers away to Weismar. In Weismar, the first frame of the film was made, out of a tower window at the St. Mary Church. The tower was destroyed in a bombing raid in World War II. The shot was achieved with a telephoto lens. In contemporary newspaper articles, there are some interesting clues. On July 31st, 1921, an ad appeared searching for 30 to 50 rats. It seems almost a joke that on the following day, the advertisement of a rat catcher appears. On August 2nd and 3rd, articles about the shooting of Nosferatu were published. At that time, the team had already been in Weismar several days. For the scenes on the open sea, the sail ship Jürgen was rented and was towed from Weismar Harbor to the island of Pohl. On day two of the shoot, St. George Church was filmed and the harbor scenes on the following day. And on the third day, the shooting work in Weismar ended with the shoots in the harbor. First thing in the morning, the arrival of the ship was filmed. the camera, fitted with a telephoto lens, was placed on an outcrop of the harbor basin. The sailing ship Jürgen was positioned at the front side of the so-called Watergate. At lunchtime, Nosferatu was filmed, again with a telephoto lens, as he passes through the gate. In the background, the sailing ship is visible. Finally, the film work was finished in Weismar, but with fewer rats than originally planned. More of the scenes of the film had been shot nearby on the day before. The individual locations were, once again, situated close together. In all, the shoots in Weismar were done in a few days, with few participants and with little financial cost. The marketplace is in reality the inner court of the Holy Ghost Church, located just 200 meters away from the harbor. The scene in which Nosferatu walks by with a casket was shot at 2 p.m. Earlier, while the makeup artist transformed Max Schreck into Nosferatu, the journey of Hutter was filmed. The shadows indicate that between these two shots, only a few hours had passed. In the immediate vicinity stands the St. George Church. Destroyed during World War II, it is about to be rebuilt. Cameraman Fritz Arno Wagner placed the camera on a platform that no longer exists today. Another 100 meters away stands St. Mary Church. There, the first scenes were filmed that depict the morning. On the fourth day, the Nosferatu team filmed on the island of Sylt. There, Murnau shot the beach scenes. On August 7th, Walter Spies writes a letter to his mother. According to Spies, Murnau was so thrilled by the shoots on the sailing ship Jürgen that he wants to rent a big yacht and sail to Java or Honolulu. Spies likes the idea, but first, he goes with the team to the Tatra Mountains and perhaps to Istanbul. Spies accompanies Murnau as an artistic consultant. On August 17th, he writes a postcard to his brother from Prague. They are on their way to the High Tatra, located in the Carpathian mountain range. They make a break in Prague for a brief vacation. Spies is enthusiastic about the beautiful paintings they see in the cathedral. Alban Grau reports in a newspaper article that he met a former war comrade in an old inn that was frequented by Emperor Rudolf II. They spent the evening exchanging vampire stories and talked until late at night. Customs at the Masaryk Railroad Station in Prague held their camera for 3 days until they got it back for 5,000 kronen in custom fees and some more in bribes. In another article, Grau reports from the shoot in the High Tatra.
Finally, we arrived in Poprad. In front of us rises the gigantic Tatra. We rented 2 wagons, horses and a postal coach, and went up into the Silesia hut, altitude 1,700 meters. We were all on foot. Only the coachman stayed on the coach boxes. Every half hour they stopped and drank a hefty gulp of schnapps. During the shooting, they showed a lot of skill and behaved like good extras. We spent the night in a hut, not far from the Polish border. The next day we climbed, loaded with the gear, up into the mountain ridge. And after an ascent of 7 hours, we reached the peak. Glorious air, the gigantic mountains, an image of overwhelming force. From Poprad, we walked through Kualovny until Dolny Kubin.
Walter Spies' card indicates that they arrived there on August 25th, 1921.
We transformed one of the wagons into a ghost coach on the marketplace, while the people looked on in amazement.
Murnau notes in a script that the coach in the forest and other scenes were shot in Vratna. Vratna lies about 20 kilometers from Dolny Kubin. Murnau notes, the coach crosses a white forest. To achieve the ghost-like appearance, the image was projected as negative. The coach had to be wrapped in white cloth in order to look black. Only 10 kilometers further on lies the castle Orawski Podzamok.
Here in Dolny Kubin stands a castle on the steepest rock. Incredible.
Murnau notes in a script simply Podzamok, referring to the castle. The shooting in the Orawski castle went quietly and swiftly. The Slovaks, according to Grau, were skilled and cunning dealers and put the sets always back in order so that they could ask the production for more money each time.
The people watched the ghost-like pale figure of the Nosferatu actor with horror and shunned him like the devil.
Some scenes were shot around the castle. Interestingly, Murnau always used the telephoto lens for scenes that could have been shot with another lens. Edgar G. Ulmer, equipment assistant in several Murnau films, explained in a later interview, quote, "While other directors shot with a focal distance of 32 or 34, Murnau shot such scenes with a focal distance of 75. He knew how to use the lenses because he knew the secrets of optics." Apparently, only one camera was used because the only preserved double shot originated from the same camera. Not all locations of Nosferatu still exist. Some parts of the castle are no longer there. Some other settings have changed a lot since then.
We finally were able to realize all the shots we had planned. After a fierce dispute concerning the payment for the coachman, we left the village satisfied. When we came to Rutka, a raft was waiting for us on the Varg. It is fascinating how the river winds its way through the steep rocks. The raftmen, quiet, tall and burly men, were upset to have to guide such eerie freight. The caskets, downriver. But we were able to accomplish our work and return to Berlin.
Up to a few years ago, Slovakian raftsmen were still transporting freight on the Vog to Budapest. And exactly here, Murnau and Grau found the ruins of the castle Trenčanski Štarad that can be seen at the end of the film in an improvised scene not contained in the script. Inspired by the original locations, the interior shots were done in Berlin. This door, for instance, is reminiscent of the one in the towers of the castle in Dolny Kubin. And this setting was adapted from a painting in Lübeck. Walter Spies introduces the composer Hans Erdmann to Murnau. He is to write the incidental music for the film. A big press campaign is arranged for the opening of Nosferatu. Alban Grau creates a great number of drawings, writes and commissions articles in which he announces that he had produced a truly occult film. The premiere of the first truly occult film was followed by a glittering costume party. But Nosferatu did not meet with great success. The many projects and dreams that Grau had for Prana film popped like soap bubbles, and Bram Stoker's widow sued Prana over not having bought the rights for her husband's novel. The verdict ordered the destruction of the film. Fortunately, some copies were saved. Grau and his partners founded a new production company named Pan. They produced their next film, Warning Shadows, based on an idea by Grau, who again took over the artistic supervision of the whole production. This time, the director was Arthur Robison, who had worked with Grau on Pietro the Corsar. Later on, Grau worked as set designer for UFA on several productions, and in 1925 retired permanently into the world of occultism.
Das ist zum Beispiel eine der höchst seltenen Publikationen von Albin Grau. Das erschien circa 1925. Davon wurden nur 300 Exemplare gedruckt und diese kleine Schrift zeichnete dann eben Albin Grau unter seinem Logennamen Pacitius. Das sogenannte Buch der Nullstunde. Mitte der 20er Jahre schied dann Gregorius, das heißt Eugen Grosche, aus der pansophischen Loge unter Tränker aus. Die hatten sich gestritten. Und Albin Grau ging mit in diese neue Gründung, die Fraternita Saturni. Die hatte auch ihren Hauptsitz in Berlin und ist dann in den 30er Jahren irgendwann verboten worden.
The Fraternitas Saturni published articles and drawings by Grau in the magazine Saturn Gnosis, like this one of the magician Cornelius Agrippa, or this one, which depicts Eliphas Levy, the creator of the picture that so deeply impressed Grau. The dark side of the blessing is the devil, and the shadow is the dark, malevolent side of reality. The film Warning Shadows is based on this principle. For the film posters, Grau picked the idea of the hand whose shadow shows the face of the devil. Murnau was himself fascinated by the ideas of occultism. Grau writes that in cinema, shadow is more important than light. Cinema is the language of shadows. Through shadow, the hidden and dark forces become visible. Inspired by a painting by Caspar David Friedrich, Murnau develops the following formal idea. In order to show the dark side, dominated by occult forces, he uses backlight. The historical period of Nosferatu is the so-called Biedermeier. In order to recreate the atmosphere of this time and its everyday life, Murnau and Grau go back to a painting by George Friedrich Kersting, The Elegant Reader. They take inspiration from Hugo Steiner Prague. Grau published his portrait of Paracelsus in the magazine Saturn Gnosis, and also from paintings by Moritz von Schwind. As an actress in Nosferatu, Murnau chose, among others, Ruth Lanzhoff because she reminded him of a portrait by Kaulbach. Other ideas for Nosferatu came from Grau's interest in magical mathematics. For instance, the picture on the wall of the Paracelsian professor shows arithmetic according to Athanasius Kircher. An illustration in the vampire book has been borrowed from a religious motif against the evil eye. As for the coded notes which Nosferatu sends out, Grau got inspired by the Oriental Order of the Knights Templar, by the coded epistles of Slovak feudal lords, or by magic publications by Grau and Trinker.
Das sind hier die Chiffren zum achten Grad im System der Gold- und Rosenkreuzer. Dieses alte System hat insgesamt 10 Grade und jeder eigene Grad hat seine jeweilige quasi Geheimschrift, um Logenmitteilungen zu verschicken, sich zu verständigen untereinander.
Until his death in 1971, Albin Grau was interested in Egyptian mythology.
Das ist das Zeichen am dritten Tor, so nannte es jedenfalls Albin Grau.
After Walter Spies got to know Grau, he created a Hymn of the Sun and devoted himself to the study of old Egyptian hieroglyphs.
Für Ägypten, ja, ja, hier in Deutschland hat er so, ja, sogar die Schrift also erforscht, wollen wir mal so sagen. Und ja, da hat er sich hier sehr engagiert.
Grau's preoccupation with Egyptian culture definitely inspired Walter Spiess's interest in occultism. And as for Murnau, did he have an attraction to it?
Das stimmt. Da ist die Rede von gewesen.
Was er nun davon geglaubt hat, da hat er immer, das ist dieses etwas, wenn ihm jemand was erzählte, dieses etwas mokante Lächeln, was er aufsetzte. Und im Übrigen behielt er seine Ansicht für sich. Ja, er sagte das ja dann nicht.